YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Let's come to order. This is the August 20th, 2018, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five commissioners are here. So, Mr. Byrd, Commissioner Byrd, if you would lead us in the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In recognition of the wide diversity of faiths that we have in our community, I would like to offer a moment of silence so that each of us can pray in our own way or not at all. And as we do, I would like to ask that we please remember why we are here, so that this body can collectively lead and govern our county government in a manner that is best for our community. Let's remember the victims and survivors of human trafficking, domestic violence, sexual assault, elder abuse, and the toxic stress associated with adverse childhood experiences. Let's remember those that are suffering from other forms of oppression, enslavement, abuse, crime, systemic racism, and social injustices, including those that have committed crimes, who have paid their debt to society, but who earnestly want to change their ways and become productive citizens, but need jobs and stable housing. Let's remember those that are homeless and hungry, especially our children, and those that are suffering from mental and physical illnesses and the challenges of aging. And lastly but not least, let's remember our first responders, our law enforcement officers, and our uniformed armed services personnel who put themselves in harm's way every day to protect us. So with these things in mind, let's have a moment of silence. Thank you very much. If you would join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next on the agenda are the public speakers. Before we jump into that, I want to talk briefly about the public comment policy. Do we have the book that lists the speakers and their names?
It's the same as on the agenda.
Okay, great. There's five. Thank you. So the public comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Each person desiring to speak gets 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. There is no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. That would be 3 speakers in favor of something and 3 speakers who are not in favor of something. At the end of the 3 minutes, I will ask the speaker to please stop speaking and return to his or her seat. And that's not a reflection on my opinion about what that person's saying or anything else about that person. It's like the shot clock in college basketball. When the shot clock goes off, you take the ball from one team and give it to the other. It's just the same, just being a referee. Speakers, please address the board from the lectern at the front of the room, right here, and begin your remarks by stating your name and address. Public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Please address your comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience are not allowed. And then there's some other common sense stuff about behaving yourself and not being ugly. And don't verbally attack people. So, and then we also have in our rules of procedure that were adopted by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, decorum of the audience. Please refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding. That may include, but is not limited to, cheers, hissing, booing, clapping, cursing, or any other conduct which disturbs the proceedings. So with that being said, and I'm just going to pause to note that we have an interpreter with us tonight, I believe, somebody who is interpreting. I guess you have some kind of system in place where you people have a receiver where they can get that. Okay. That's unusual for us, but that's a great idea. So thank you for providing that service to the people who are with you. So the first public speaker is Jeff Eichinger.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Jeff Eichinger. I live at 2230 Cherry Lane in Haw River. I better read this so I stay on task here. As an HVAC controls engineer, I belong to ACHE, which is a professional engineering society for the heating and air conditioning field. As a member, I saw presentations on climate change, and that won me over. The numbers don't lie, and that is why that, according to NASA, that 97% of climate scientists agree that global warming is happening and that it is human-caused. And one key result of global warming is that the severity of storms is increased, and I think that is something any county commissioner would find very interesting. This and the other negative results of global warming are why we should be looking at renewable energy sources like solar and wind instead of natural gas. Don't get me wrong, we need natural gas in the mix. It is a source of energy that's better than coal, but it's not where we should be planning our future. We know the dangers of leaks and explosions, single payment easements, and the use of eminent domain. Well, frankly, they're a crappy way to treat landowners. Whereas renewable energy is safer, and companies and landowners can form a partnership that benefit both for years to come. But we have a substance abuse problem when it comes to fossil fuels. And big gas and oil don't want us getting off this addiction, which is exactly why we should be working to replace some of their use with healthier alternatives. Adding a new natural gas pipeline to replace the use of coal is like going to the doctor because we can't control how much whiskey we like to drink. And he suggests switching to beer because it's not as bad. And he'll even give us some coupons that can be used at the grocery store. The money behind this effort is all too evident when you look at the federal and state agencies who we should be able to trust with making good decisions for all of us. They have pretty much relinquished their oversight of this project to others who in turn handed it off to someone else. According to the Charleston Gazette and ProPublica, it started with the state agencies in West Virginia and has gone through several federal agencies before ending up with FERC, who have pretty much given MVP a free pass to ignore FERC's regulations. For example, one FERC regulation mandates that rivers cannot be dammed for more than 72 hours during construction. However, in their own plan, MVP said each river they crossed in West Virginia would be dammed from 4 to 6 weeks. FERC approved it without any objection to this. Thank you.
Thank you. Lee Hicks.
My name is Lee Hicks, and I live at 950 Border Lake Trail, Burlington, North Carolina, on Border Lake Farm. The only reason that we are still amongst a handful of people that can say they are fortunate enough to live on a farm is due to the sacrifices made by generations before us. I was blessed to work on our farm alongside my late father-in-law, Freddie Blanchard. He instilled in me the value of the land. He always said never take anything off of it that you don't plan on putting back in. To always strive to leave it better for future generations. Over the years, people have approached us about clear-cutting our timber, cell phone towers, and housing developments. They have thrown out big numbers to try and persuade us. The answer has always been no. Could we have used the money at times? Of course we could have. But like Freddie always said, what you cut down in 30 minutes will take 30 years to replace. You may sit there and think we're crazy for passing up what so many people see as easy money opportunities. But there's no such thing as easy money. Everything comes at a price, and it's just a matter of whose expense. The MVP pipeline is proposed to run right through the heart of our farm, by our pond, our barns, and directly in front of our houses. It crosses pasture land and hay fields. Even the alternative route mentioned utilizes our prime agricultural land. Over the years, we've made sacrifices and gone without to ensure that we keep the land we love so dear. The point I'm trying to get across is that we are happy and content with our life and all that it entails. And that life doesn't include having a for-profit pipeline run through the middle of it at nobody's expense but our own. We're located in the critical watershed area, which means we can't disturb soil around creeks or the lake. It means we can't fertilize in these areas and have to fence livestock out as well due to being a watershed. We have always followed these rules, but now almost in a matter of overnight, it's okay for a pipeline to cross and possibly contaminate the creeks and streams to run a gas line. It has been stated that area mills need the gas when in fact there's no proven shortage and merely profit margins at stake for those involved, as expressed during the last meeting by PSNC's own Bill McCauley. We understand making sacrifices for the greater good, like many years ago when the old city lake was built. Utilizing a portion of our land, it was to provide the city of Burlington with a source of drinking water. This was a need for the area. In my opinion, the pipeline initiative has been nothing but misleading from the get-go. There are still people to this day in our county that feel forced to comply with the requests and letters from the companies involved due to their misleading and unethical practices. They use big words and fancy terminology to try to persuade landowners. The 2015 natural gas study conducted by the U.S. Department of Energy even states between 1998 and 2013, 54% was the utilization rate. For comparison, the top 200 pipeline segments by projected flow volume in the reference case in 2030 was only 57. In my opinion, the necessity has not been justified. This board needs to take a stand with the private landowners of Alamance County and put our people over the private industry's profit margins. Land condemnation for the sake of others' private wealth is tyranny. I ask that you consider signing a resolution explicitly opposing this pipeline. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you.
David Naylor.
David, how you doing?
I'm doing well, thank you, sir. Glad I haven't had to see you.
Bill may need an adjustment.
That's right.
My name is David.
He used to give me a lot of adjustment.
I'm sorry. I had to
Don't start the clock.
My name is David Naylor. I live at 1523 Jimmy Carr Road in Hall River. My land joins the Alamance Community College property. Of course, I'm going to be affected by the pipeline should it come through the property that way. And I have concerns for myself, but I have concerns for the school also. There's all kinds of regulations, guidelines for the environment and safety in building pipelines. And MVP pipeline may never have a failure, but this company has a small, limited past. We don't know much about them. When I was in school and took my oath to practice, it was drilled into our heads, first do no harm. And this has been a mantra for me in my practice with my patients and for my personal life for the past 40 years. I wonder if an investment company seeking profit ever considers such thoughts. My son-in-law knows a pipeline worker working in the trenches for MVP, and his opinion is no, they don't. I heard Richard Petty once say, it ain't cheating unless you call it. According to the U.S. Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration, the Pipeline Safety Trust, there were 6,081 pipeline incidents in the pre-1940 pipelines. Since 2010, there's been 6,640, a whole lot more in just a short period of time. Of course, these range from excavation errors, improper installation, to full ruptures and explosions. And there have been explosions this year in West Virginia. Total fatalities from statistics that I could find from 2002 to 2014 were 199. Injuries were 799, and this is out of 8,321 incidents. So it does happen, and I agree when you bring it down to just numbers and statistics, it's very small. But when it's your child standing in the parking lot and an explosion takes his life or injures him from a school pipeline incident, that's big. First, do no harm. This size line has a blast zone radius of 660 feet and an evacuation zone of over 2,200 feet. And it's actually more considering the hazardous materials that will be released. This pipeline will run between the Hall River and the back parking lot of the ACC. First responders can take care of the buildings and the vehicles, but they can't stop the gas. They've got to cut that, that has to be shut off. We all have to consider the consequences and cost for preparation and wages, preparation of emergency personnel, equipment, downtime for the school, lost wages, and the effect on the community and the industry relying on the school. So I ask that you vote for a resolution against the NV pipeline in your area. I want to thank you again for your time, and I appreciate the sacrifices y'all make to help Alamance County.
Thank you so much. All right, so we've had three speakers to speak against the MVP pipeline. We have two more signed up, Milton Marin and Selena Santos. So if either of these people want to speak against the pipeline, if you would just say pass. But if there's something else on your mind that you want to speak about, then this is the time to do it. Are you Mr. Milton Marin?
Yeah.
Do you want to speak against the pipeline or something else?
That's something else.
Okay, please come forward.
Good afternoon. My name is Milton Marin. I came here to speak against 287G that will, in which it basically that it lets the civil protection and also ICE to basically work together, and that whenever someone gets stopped, they'll be able to, you know, ask for their papers. And personally, I don't agree with it, and most of the people here that came with me don't either. Mainly due to the fact that this type of legislation might cause a distrust between the Hispanic community and public safety, due to the fact that there's a lot of fear when it comes to these type of situations. Since back in, before like 2012, when 287G was passed beforehand, many Hispanics at that time, and well, I was in elementary at the time, knew about this type of legislation, and we didn't, we had a lot of fear of going outside and drive and being stopped, those with and without papers. Mostly because the abuse that can 287G can bring with racial profiling, and mainly how it undermines public safety. So one more thing is that a lot of children from the Hispanic community made letters for all five commissioners. Right now, I want to pass it out.
That's fine.
But basically that civil protection should be protecting the community, and that they shouldn't, that there's a lot of debate about the immigration question, and that it's the, when it comes to public safety, it's already pretty complicated these days, and that, these days, and mostly.
Thank you very much.
That any political thing that could, you know, make an officer question.
Thank you.
Make it hard for them to protect.
I wanted a student to bring them
back. So basically that public safety should be put at foremost instead of someone's their state of being here, basically. So thank you for hearing me out, and I hope you guys have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Great. Selena Santos.
Mi nombre es Edith Rodríguez. Vivo en 1129 Jackson Street.
My name is Edith Rodríguez, and I live at 1129 Jackson Street.
Okay, which one are you, Selena Santos? I thought she said Rodríguez.
Selena Santos is her daughter, and she couldn't come, so she's speaking.
Okay, great.
In her place.
Thank you.
So yo estoy en contra de la 287G porque yo fui detenida equivocadamente por ser hispana.
I am against 287G because I was wrongly detained because I am Latina.
Fui detenida en el 2012 por migración. He tenido yo aquí un permiso.
I was detained in 2012 here in Alamance County by immigration. I had a permit to be legally in the country.
Mis hijos estuvieron llorando fuera de la detención por 4 horas.
My kids were crying outside of the detention center waiting for me for 4 hours.
Lo que yo no quiero es que esto pase con otras familias.
What I don't want is for other families to go through this.
Muchas gracias por escucharme. Tengo mucho más que decirle, pero sé que el tiempo no es suficiente y no quiero atrasar la reunión.
Thank you so much for listening to me. I have much more I could say about this, but I know that the time is short and I don't want to hold up your meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, that's all of our public speakers. Do we have commissioners' responses?
I'd like to say something. Okay. I'll reserve my comments to the pipeline issue to later on when it's on the agenda. But I would like to make a comment about the 287G. So about 3 weeks ago, I was asked by Siembra NC to speak in front of the Latinx group, probably to most of the people that are in the back room here. And they wanted to hear from a public official, and so I was able to tell them about county government and what it does and some of the services that we provide. But then it was opened up for questions, and of course they told me their story. Ms. Rodriguez actually presented the long version of her story, and it was very touching. And, but I expressed my opposition to 287G, that, and I've been public with that position for a long time now. I spoke at a down-home rally that got press coverage. I mentioned it at the public forum that the Times News had during before the primary election. And I've spoken to the sheriff about my position on that, and he assures me we're going to still have a great working relationship, even though I'm against that particular program. And it was really touching that a lot of the kids there, and that this. They presented with me with some artwork. It's different than what was just presented with us, but I found this one particularly touching. What they're thinking of life before 287G and after 287G. And I just, you know, I mentioned that our Latino community, the Latinx community, is just a very important part of our community with their vibrancy and the economic impact that they have on the community and how that. Having the 287G, regardless of how you feel about it, the fact is that it's going to have a chilling effect on that vibrancy and on the economic impact. And that, and I'm really concerned about the huge liability that it presents to us, because we're going to have all these organizations outside threatening to bring legal action to us because of any kind of perceived irregularities in the way any part of the program would be administered. And we've been through that. We already went through a lot of legal challenges in the past, and I just don't think that it behooves us to put us in that liability, particularly when there are other options for the sheriff that I think that you have to get the kind of information that you need to reduce crime. And I really believe that you're thinking in the best interest of our community with respect to criminal behavior from regardless of what group of people is committing the criminal behavior. But I just felt like there's so many negatives about it, and there aren't a whole lot of positives in my view. In the whole idea about, you know, we're all human beings, and this concept about being stopped or being tagged because of skin color or accent that one might have in their speech, when in fact those people could be U.S. citizens, bona fide U.S. citizens. So, I mean, I wouldn't want to be stopped just because of the color of my skin, or et cetera. So I just think that it opens up a whole can of worms to get into it. I just wanted to express that in response to what we heard tonight. Thank you.
Anybody else?
I would like to say something. I don't consider myself anything but what I am. I try to live a Christian life, and I resent people who are ashamed that they have a God. I happen to believe in God, and I detest people who don't. And I'm sorry I feel that way. No, I'm not sorry I feel that way. That's the way I feel. And that's the chew, Bob.
I was wondering why
you're ashamed. If you're ashamed, you're a God. You're a Christian. I know you are. I happen to believe that Christians are the way to live and to treat people. And when you die, you're going to answer to the same God that I answer to.
Mr. Sutton?
Present. I have nothing to say.
I have some things to say. Well, I'd like to ask Mr. Bird, since you're speaking against the 287G program, can you explain to us what it is that the sheriff wants to do? Exactly what is it that he wants to do that you find objectionable?
Well, mostly it's the jail program, I understand. I didn't see that in the draft agreement. But so if somebody's detained, then they go through a process where they're checked out with ICE, whether if they're suspected of not having the proper documentation to be in the country.
And so how does...
But there's other... But that can happen without actually having the 287G program. The Safe Communities program? I mean, I'm not an expert at this. But Sheriff maybe could clarify.
Well, I believe that, from my understanding and speaking with the sheriff, that the Safe Communities database, that's the name of it, it has a tremendous amount of information from the FBI, other states, law enforcement agencies, and it has the criminal database for ICE. It does not have the civil database for ICE. So what the sheriff wants to do is to have the ICE database that is civilly based in the jail. That's the only way he can get that information. And then when somebody is brought to his jail, he can figure out who this is. That's the purpose of the 287G, is to determine who it is that's in the jail, so he can assure the safety of that person and also the other people in the jail. You said that a negative of it is that people are being stopped and tagged because of their skin color or their speech. How does the 287G proposal of the sheriff lead them to being stopped and tagged because of their skin color and their speech?
Well, actually, so what I hear from law enforcement officers, it's pretty hard even to see through the windshield of vehicles. I mean, so a lot of that is maybe not so prevalent. But I think that it just having it in place, there's a fear from the Latinx community that it's going to promote that targeting. And there's just that fear, and we hear it. We just heard it just now.
How does the fear promote targeting? How does the community's fear, which I think comes from people who are politicizing the 287G and encouraging them to be afraid of law enforcement by giving them misinformation about what the program actually is, because the Sheriff's Department isn't going out and picking up the people. It's people who are brought to the jail by Burlington, by Mebane, by Elon, by Gibsonville, by Hall River. So how does... Knowing that not all people are brought to the jail, right? It has to be something, not infractions. Something stopped for the first time driving without a license, they're not brought to the jail, it's a ticket. They're let go. And it goes back to what Mr. Marine was saying, that he said in his comments that he said that people, when they're stopped, are asked for their papers. And that is not true. They're not under 287G, and Sheriff Johnson wants to do it. Nobody is asked for their papers when they're stopped. What happens is there's a reason they've committed some kind of misdemeanor or felony that results in them being taken to the jail and processed. And then they're asked, who are you? to ensure the safety of that person, other people in the jail.
Well, there seems to be an inconsistency, because I'm hearing from the actual people being involved, and this is what they're describing as what they've experienced. And Ms. Rodriguez, that she explained that in a lot more detail. I mean, and it wasn't that long ago.
It was 6 years ago, right?
She said 2012 is what she said.
She was detained in 2012, so 6 years ago. So are you saying that Sheriff Johnston should have his hands tied now because of something that happened 6 years ago?
You think he doesn't have the tools now to accomplish what he needs to accomplish?
I think so. I think that's why he wants the program. That's because it gives him a tool that he needs. I do. Okay. And that's why I support 287G. I think that there has been an incredible amount of misinformation spread in the Latin community. I think that where the fear comes from, it comes from people who claim to be their advocates, who are encouraging them to see law enforcement as being hostile to them, when what the sheriff wants to do is to protect them. Almost every conversation that I've had, I can't say every single conversation, couldn't put my hand on the Bible and say that, but every conversation that I can recall having with the sheriff regarding 287G, he has repeatedly emphasized to me his care and concern for the Latin community, his care and concern about the cartels who are hiding in that community and using them as a shield to screen them. And the sheriff is the one who walks in the, and his officers are the ones who go in the crime scene when something has gone bad. And if he says he needs this tool to help him, I think that he is a very admirable man who has paid a personal price for this program. And if he says he needs it, then I support him.
So the sheriff and I have had lots of personal conversations about this, and I have no doubt in his sincerity of wanting to protect this community. I have no doubt about that. So I agree with that part. But the liability, the threat of lawsuits, I think that's... there are lots of advocacy groups out there that are watching us very closely. You know, the Forsyth County and Guilford County withdrew from the program.
White County's in it.
Yeah, they might be withdrawing as well.
There are a lot of
But because of those liabilities, I mean, what's the name of the sheriff in Guilford County? I mean,
B.J. Barnes.
And they've got B.J. Barnes, and upon advice from their legal counsel, and our own legal counsel is advising us not to get involved in the program. And because the reason that Forsyth and Guilford counties got out of the program is because it's really stretching the I can't remember which amendment of the between the 4th and the 14th amendments of the Constitution. I mean, it's very iffy whether or not it's even constitutional. So,
well, you talk about the detainment. I will speak on it now. I expect I go back on 287G more than anybody in this county as an elected official. And I pushed it hard when it first came out. It was a section of the law, the 1986 Illegal Alien or Illegal Immigration Act or whatever. There's a little paragraph. And it basically said, if you feel like you have a problem, you can ask for permission to do this. Mecklenburg was the first county. We were the... I guess second in the state, eighth in the nation to do it. And, you know, Mecklenburg's backing out now because of an election. They had a new guy that was elected in a primary, and he ran on the campaign of getting rid of it. But, you know, it's kind of funny to me that, you know, I was doing some research on the number of counties that are doing it across the United States. Charleston, South Carolina, of all communities, have 287G. I mean, it doesn't. It's not a measure of intelligence or whether or not you're vindictive or whether or not you are backwards in time or whatever. I mean, it's just people controlling their own communities. Here's what I've told our sheriff. I hate he went through what he went through.
Me too.
I hate that we went through it. But we did take a stand that we felt like we needed to take, and we won. I mean, when you beat the Justice Department, Eric Holder's Justice Department, that's something to be, in my opinion, proud of. But the bottom line is, I've told your sheriff, I will not push him to do it like I didn't push him before. I just asked him, are you willing to do it? And he said, are you willing to support me? I said, of course. And we went with it. The rest is history. I'm not ashamed of that involvement. And we were recognized nationally for some of our involvement, for good reasons and for some, maybe in some people's eyes, not so good reasons. But if he wants to do it, I'll support it. But I'm not going to get on my stump like I did before and ask him because of respect for our sheriff. He went through heck, and I hate to see him have to go through it again. If he wants to do it, he knows he's got my vote. And I'll never back off of my belief that we need to do something in this nation for those who just don't believe they need to follow the rules or they're not following the rules. And I don't know what else to say about it, but I'll definitely support it if he wants to do it.
All right. Thank you. So, next on our agenda is approval of the agenda. If everybody's had an opportunity to review it.
I'll make the motion to approve it.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the consent agenda. Everyone has had the opportunity to review.
I'll move that we approve that.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Great. Next is a public hearing. This is regarding amendments to the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance. So I would be seeking a vote, or say, seeking, excuse me, a motion to open a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to open a public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, so now we're having a public hearing on amendments to the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance. Is there anybody on this side of the room that would like to be heard regarding the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance? If not, is there anybody on this side of the room that would like to be heard on the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance? Could somebody run and check with people in the overflow room and make sure there's nobody in there that wants to be heard? We're good? All right. So we have nobody who wants to be heard on the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance. So could I be seeking a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. So, what's that watershed ordinance amendment all about, Ms. Hook?
So basically what I'm here tonight for is to follow up on the Jordan Lake Buffer Protection Program. There was an audit that was done last year, 2017. During this audit, an issue of non-compliance was identified in our current watershed supply ordinance. And what we're doing is just asking that some of the missing legislative revisions that were passed between 2013 and 17 be added back into our ordinance. We sent a response to the state for suggested revisions. I brought that to the board several months ago. They've reviewed it. They agreed to our responses. I've taken this to the planning board, and they have agreed or recommended that this be brought to the Board of Commissioners for approval. So that's what we're doing tonight, is just asking that changes be adopted into the watershed supply ordinance.
I have a question. How long will it be before the state recognizes the GIS system?
We don't have a time frame on that. So, I mean, we're using our current maps, but we don't have a time frame for when the new maps will be adopted.
Seems like we're a little bit ahead of the state.
I think we're ahead of the game.
That's
yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
And it's something we don't have a choice.
No, this is really, it's just basically bringing us into compliance, yeah. So.
All right.
I guess I'm not going to make the motion. I'll vote for it, but I'm not making that motion.
I'll make the motion to adopt the revised rules.
I'll second that, Bob.
Thank you.
Excuse
me. We have a motion and a second to adopt these changes into the watershed ordinance. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Excuse me, I swallowed wrong a minute ago. That's why I'm a mess right now. Yeah, beat on my back. Thank you. I'm trying to get through it without a recess. All right, Mr. Albright.
Yes.
You have a resolution for us to talk
about. I've presented the board with a draft of a resolution that's not complete. but when this appeared on the agenda, I went ahead and sent you a copy of the draft. Open for any comments, any changes the board decides they want to add, take away from.
So I have some things to say about that.
What I've tried to do is base it on our vision plan, a balanced approach to economic development, recreation protection, and business, economic concerns of citizens for property that will may or may not be taken. I would like to say also that from what I've studied about the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and I'm no expert on this, and there's a lot to learn, but when the pipeline went through Virginia, they made over 500 changes to their proposed route. And we're in a pre-filing period right now. Tonight, as we sit here in this meeting, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission is in Reidsville taking public comments about environmental issues. It's called scoping, according to the letter I sent all of you on Wednesday last week. And the scoping process continues. It'll be in Chatham, Virginia tomorrow night from 8 to 5. It'll be in Hall River Thursday night from 8 to 5, where the citizens, many of whom are here tonight, get a chance to talk to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission folks face-to-face and tell them what their concerns are. And that's where we are at this stage. The pipeline has about six, so far, alternate routes. It's based on, as I understand it, the depth of the rock on the property that they propose to go through. I talked to a gentleman in Reidsville who is a personal friend of mine. He called me this weekend. They're going to come through his farm. And he's got rock about 3 feet below the surface, so they may not come through his farm. They may elect to go around it. So that's the issue we're faced with. I think we're really at a preliminary stage. But if the board wants to prepare a resolution, we can certainly do that. Whatever changes you want to make to this. What I've tried to do with this is take a snapshot of the state regulators and the Public Utilities Commission who came up with the 2013 decision that we probably do need another pipeline because electrical generation is switching from coal to natural gas. And Duke Energy has the Atlantic Coast Pipeline in the hopper now, in the process now. They're going to fire five new gas-fired generation plants in eastern North Carolina if the project goes through. But who knows? This one, I don't know if it'll go through. I don't know if it'll meet the environmental requirements. I've told them in the resolution to stay away from our river because the river is an important source of recreation and water for this county. Water is very important. We're going to run out of it before we run out of land. So other things in the resolution, I've tried to cover it all. My goal is to not upset people because I know what it's like to have your property condemned on a personal basis. It's not something anyone wants to go through. So that's where I stand with the resolution and the resolve clauses. You may notice number 5 is blank because I was in the middle of making some more resolutions. So I'm happy to make any changes this board decides they want to make.
Well, I think we've all heard from a whole lot of people. I expect most of our emails have been duplicated for all of us. And predominantly, they're all opposed, with the exception of maybe 4 or 5 messages that we got. And I think so much of the opposition is based on that this is being proposed, driven by economics, if there's a need for more energy, nobody is considering what Mr. Eichinger mentioned about renewable energies instead, because the technology is now to the point where we can provide renewable energy at the same or less cost than natural gas energy. So there's a couple of independent studies that say that there really isn't an unmet need with expanding existing pipelines, adding some natural gas storage areas, reversing the Transco pipeline was mentioned in one of the studies, which increases capacity. I don't quite understand that. One study says that if you add in the renewables, there's plenty of ways to be able to eliminate all of the coal-fired plants with new energy sources without adding to the fossil fuel. Gas is a fossil fuel. I was talking to a friend today who just got back from visiting Southwest Pennsylvania. Her dad lives on a farm where there's a lot of fracking. You mentioned water, preserving water. She says you can hardly drive to her dad's farm because of all the water trucks. And it's just in all the heavy road utilization from these big water trucks, because that's what is required to get gas using that process. And then she's driving back, she's talking about all the, you can see the construction of the pipelines through West Virginia. So we're asking landowners to make some pretty big sacrifices and really upset farmland, which we want to preserve, and we want to preserve our natural resources, because once we lose it, we lose it forever. And it just seems like there's so much gamble with respect to possible, even if it's not as bad as what people say, and I think it could be worse, actually. But there's a lot at stake in the fact that there's not even a demonstrated need, at least not a demonstrated need by MVP might think there's a demonstrated need, but they're not considering all the other options out there. It's not a real comprehensive analysis necessarily, and it's being driven by economic factors. It makes me want to think, like Mr. Eichinger, talks about the money behind the fossil fuel industry and the impact that they have on our legislation, which happened to do away with tax credits for solar energy. I mean, I have solar panels on my house. It would have been a stretch to have put those on there 4 years ago if I didn't get the state tax credits to help pay for that, and the federal tax credits too. But the prices have come down quite a bit lately. But the investors in the pipelines, they have a guaranteed return on their investment. I mean, that's legislated that way, and that's a pretty hefty return. It's a better return than what you get in most other investments. And I guess it gets built into the rates that people pay later on. So what if we had those same kind of investment incentives applied to the solar industry? I bet you it would make a huge difference in moving down to this new technology, because the use of fossil fuels is an outdated technology. We can do better now, thinking about the overall future, and it's cost effective from the standpoint of the jobs that it creates, and it keeps the money in our regional economy. You have to build the solar farms and the wind farms, and then you have to maintain them, so that's going to take some manpower. Unlike with providing natural gas, I mean, you got pipelines being maintained elsewhere in other parts of the country, and we're going to be paying for fuel coming out of the fracking mines, whatever you can call them. So that's money leaving our economy. So I mean, there's economic benefits to go down this path, and we're at the place in our in the technology that we can really do that. I'm opposed to it. Because I want to be sensitive to our landowners. And you mentioned scoping. So this is the time to pass a resolution as input to the scoping process. I mean, they're asking for written things, and I think what we're being asked by our constituents is to pass a resolution saying that we don't want the pipeline because we have all these concerns and we're really questioning the need, that there's really a demonstrated need. And that's what I was hoping that you would make the case for it in the resolution, but you went down a completely different path.
Well, I haven't finished it yet.
So But there's one other point.
Okay.
I can't remember what it was. But so, so I would like to see a resolution that was more definitive of that. Oh, and so I looked at a couple of other resolutions from other counties, from boards of supervisors in Virginia. You know, they call commissioners supervisors in Virginia, not commissioners. But there was one that I saw that was kind of contingent. They said, well, we're opposing it now until something else comes up that might change our mind. I mean, because so say that there really is a demonstrated need, and it's done, you know, after a result of a comprehensive assessment, utilizing the impact of all these other things. You know, I think about my house. What happens if, like, 50% of the homeowners had solar panels on their house? Don't you think that would have a pretty significant impact on the demand for gas-generated electricity? I think that would, not to mention the utility-grade solar farms. But there could be, I mean, so I think that it's possible that, you know, for those who think that, well, we don't want to shut off the ability to keep our economy moving because we weren't forward thinking enough to have gas energy to replace coal. I mean, to me, that I don't know that I would be convinced, but say it happened, at least we had it in our resolution that would allow for that. And I don't know if you have copies of those resolutions from other counties, but there's some language in there that
they're in Virginia?
Hmm?
Yeah. Virginia and West Virginia?
Virginia.
Okay, I can get those.
Well, if the county attorney doesn't have the resolution completed, I would say we'd need to table this conversation until a later date. Is that right?
Well, there is a deadline on the scoping of September 10.
Well, we can have it done by then, but what I was really interested in is getting all of your comments. Is what your concerns are.
I'm going to be honest with you. I missed the last meeting because I had something real important I had to do. And I went back and watched it on tape or YouTube, whatever. I couldn't figure out what the charge was for the resolution. I called Bob and I said, what was the charge? Pro, con, neutral, or what? And you said you didn't know, or you know, you were confused, and I definitely was confused listening to it. I talked to, you talk about the, what is it, the FERC meeting, Federal Energy Regulatory, like you say, two nights, Thursday night, I talked to today a lady in Raleigh who's with the Diener, what's that, the Department of?
DEQ, Division of Environmental Quality.
Yeah, she told me Thursday night is the night for local people. She said, if you go out to that meeting and ask questions of FERC officials, you should be able to get the answers that you want as far as capacities, need and so forth, and they want to hear those questions and they want to try to answer them. But that meeting is Thursday night.
Where was it located?
What? At the Palladium.
It's in
Hawkintosh.
Okay.
Hall River. That's correct.
Bale Tree.
Yeah. Well, Bale Tree. Bale Tree.
Bale Tree. Right there.
Bale Tree. Yeah. Bale Tree. What did I say? Palladium.
Yeah.
It's at the Bale Tree Event and Conference Center in Hall River.
And she told me that's the meeting.
What
that
time?
You need to go to
5:00 till 8 p.m.
5 to 8. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, are they there to listen or to also provide information? This is the
everything
I see, right?
But you got to ask the questions. And I mean, these are federal officials, and if you pin them down about, like I was told out of Raleigh, that the mere fact that you're still battling the Atlantic Coast pipeline, trying to get it settled, that this one coming on the heels of that without that one being fully issued yet, that's not a good deal. You know, up in Virginia, they cut, MVP cut half their workforce just last week.
Well, they had a stop work order because of erosion in the Jefferson Forest.
In the National Forest.
In the National Forest. They did, the judge told the federal wildlife people to get it together and do better on erosion control.
And, you know, so I did my homework the best I could, you know, to try to get even with y'all as a result of missing that meeting, and I lost it here. But out of Cleveland, there's an Institute for Energy Economics and Financial Analysis. And I talked to them today. They called and I asked them, I said, they've only been in existence about 5 years, and I'm going to lie to you, but I said, how did y'all come about? She said, we came about as a result of grants and appropriations from the Rockefeller Foundation studying fuel and fuel needs and so forth and infrastructure. And here's the headline of an article that they did 2 years ago says, two pipeline expansion projects in Appalachia indicate a rush toward overbuilding. The insinuation is they're just building for profit, they're building without any consideration of capacity being met or any projections of the future being normal. And the Roanoke Times wrote an article that said that when it was approved in Virginia, that it would help, what is it, EQT? Is that the name of the home parent company?
I think that's right. One of the partnerships.
EQT out of Pittsburgh, that it would help them in their competition with some Louisiana pipelines for what they're trying to get accomplished to sell gas overseas. And so it just appears that it's just, and the thing that bothered me the most is I'm against eminent domain. If you can't prove an exceptional need for the project, it's hard for me to claim that eminent domain is a worthy debate point here when in the first sentence of EQT's description for what they do and what their goals are, in the first sentence it says we're doing this for the profit of our stakeholders, of the people who own our company.
Right.
And somebody asked me, well, what'd you expect them to say? Well, I wouldn't expect that to be in the first sentence.
I mean, you go, right?
Yeah, and then I was also told that it's very ironic or concerning to me that they were willing to stop in Chatham, Virginia. I mean, they were willing to stop right there.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden now they want to come on over two more counties and come on into, they want to get to the interstate. I don't think there's any question about that. But there was another point I want to make. But, you know, I'm just opposed to she told me about a group of attorneys who are working. I think that came from, that might have come from an Institute for Economic Energy, Economics and Financial Analysis. She said there was a group of lawyers who were debating and trying to get together a criticism or the debate of eminent domain for these purposes, for profit versus true need. And to me, that's a big point. But the whole thing has a taint to it that I just can't get down my throat.
I'm with you.
I'll be honest with you.
I'm with you on that.
So, but I don't know what we do. I mean, yeah.
Well, I think we as a board can stand with the citizens, and you know they've made a lot of comments. We've got a lot of comments on this. We've got a lot of information, and there are some counties in Virginia that have done proposals against. Now, once again, a resolution is our thoughts, our ideas. But I think when we word this, we need to put in this that we as a board collectively do not agree with this and are not justified in the need of it.
So I would be in favor of that's the final resolve.
Yes, I think that's where we were trying to get with this. And I mean, I have a lot of issues with just the safety factor of it. Are we prepared here in Alamance County to do what we would have to do if it's put in and something happens?
Do you have anything else to
see? I'm good. That's pretty much
it. I'm okay.
And if we're going to do this at the next meeting, I mean, I think it needs to be part of the agenda where the public can see it.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, so a lot of the concerns that I felt like I had raised at the last meeting, I didn't feel like they were addressed in this draft. I thought we should specifically mention Jordan Lake and the Jordan Lake rules. I asked the MVP representative about whether they had experience working in the type of watershed that we have and the kind of river like the Hall River. That was a concern.
Yeah, I looked into that, and the Jordan Lake rules deal with impervious surfaces and runoff of nutrients into our streams. So this being an underground pipeline probably wouldn't fall under that category.
But what about the provisions in the Jordan Lake rules disturbing the streams that feed into
right,
the Hall
River? That's a function of the Division of Environmental Quality. Whenever a builder or anyone puts anything in, they have to have the silt fence and erosion control fences put in. But Jordan Lake specifically deals with nutrients going into the water.
I think that's partly because the Jordan Lake rules have been delayed repeatedly in their implementation. I think what you may be thinking about are the agricultural rules. The agricultural community has been required to be very careful about the fertilizer and the cows in the streams and things like that. I still think that we should have, looking forward, I think that we should have something in the resolution that addresses the Jordan Lake, the water quality, and that the Jordan Lake rules are still being discussed or, excuse me, under...
Well, we just amended our watershed ordinance tonight,
right,
to implement this. So I can plug that into this resolution.
So that was one thing. I did like the reference to the strategic plan that you had, but it was inaccurately referenced. You said that it was we adopted a smart growth and development vision plan, but what we adopted was a strategic plan entitled Vision Alamance, which included an action pillar of smart growth and development. Where then planned, but that was the second paragraph. So I did like, you know, going back to look at the vision plan, the mission statement, things like that. I had a real concern about in the fourth paragraph where we say that there were facts found by the board. There were following facts found by the board because we didn't have sworn testimony and it wasn't a public hearing. We were hearing people's opinions, but I question whether or not what we've been going through has been really a fact-finding process.
Well, the reason I framed it in that way is because I referenced the Utility Commission report. I referenced some of the other federal and state reports, which are public documents from other public agencies. But I can certainly change that language if you're not comfortable with that.
Right, because then, yeah, those are things that we didn't discuss. In my recollection in the meeting, like the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 paragraph, whereas in 2016, coal accounted for nearly 70% of carbon emissions and so forth, those aren't things that we discussed as a body. Am I wrong? I mean, did I miss
right.
that?
I don't remember that. I sent that information in the packet of material, things that I explored and found out that were already reported, so that we could have a more meaningful resolution. But those items are covered in the federal energy report under the North Carolina profile. It's U.S. Energy Information Administration. They did a complete survey of North Carolina in 2018, and they updated it August 17th of 2017, and they've updated again in 2018.
Right, but those aren't things that we talked about in the meeting, right?
No, we didn't talk about it in the meeting, but I'm trying to develop a resolution based on these facts.
Right. Right, so I've been thinking about this a lot, like everybody has. And one of my concerns is that I don't feel like as a county government, as a local government, that we have the staff. I don't feel like we have the expertise to evaluate the claims of the people of the Hall River Assembly or the pipeline representative. I found that there were competing claims and reasons to doubt each side, but on different aspects. And I'll talk about the Hall River Assemblies first. We were told that the pipeline won't help with economic development. And originally when I started talking to people about the issue, I was told that this pipeline gas is not going to be ultimately available to the people in Alamance County, which then I understand from the representative of the company, that's not true. My recollection is that at the meeting, he said that there would be a connection at the terminus at Cherry Lane, Highway 54, that if there's a company that wants to come to Alamance County, this manufacturing or industry, that they can then tap into that. That conflicted with what I had been told previously, and that confused me. And I don't know which is, who's the right person to believe there. I feel like we as a deliberative body lack the resources to sort through things like that. She said that there would be a few jobs related to construction, but potentially there's a lot of jobs connected to the pipeline if We have a manufacturing industry that comes here because we have natural gas more available. The MVP pipeline, or the representative of the company, is he here tonight?
He is.
He is.
Must be in the back
room. I saw him come in.
He didn't have to come in. I don't have a question for him. I was just wondering he's here. But trying to get an answer from him on some things was like trying to nail Jell-O to the wall. It seemed like he was just saying what they think you want to hear at the time. Mr. Boswell asked a good question. What does the homeowner get out of it? And he said they get an easement. Well, that's like saying, we're going to fight, and I'm going to give you a black eye.
You know? What you going to get out of it?
That's what you get out of it. The people, I think that to not understand the people don't want the easement, that's the whole point of the whole thing. The $1.3 million tax revenue estimate, that really bothered me. He said, I asked him about that. We talked about that. He said that that came from a consultant. And I don't think I would be alone in sharing an opinion that you can get a consultant to say a lot of things that you will pay a consultant to say. I seriously doubted that was true. But again, we lack the expertise to evaluate that. And those things lead me to question other things that the company said, that there's going to be no harm to streams, no environmental impact. That just doesn't seem credible to me. That this everything's going to be fine. Of course there's going to be harm to the stream. Of course there's going to be sediment. And you know, they can take measures the best they can to control that, but there is going to be damage. And from what I've seen, especially the materials that Mr. Sutton has made available, which I really appreciate his work and his research, the record of the pipeline company and the construction in Virginia and West Virginia does not seem to be impressive. And I have questions about the operation of this particular company. The thing that bothered me the most about the resolution is that it doesn't really talk about the landowners, the people who bear the cost, the brunt of the benefit that are given for other people. And we need to remember the landowners, that they have their plans and their dreams for their property. What we see as being an empty field, that's hope. That's a plan for them. We received an email from Wes and Brenda Hare. They bought land for their children to be nearby. And the line is planned right through the middle of that lot where it's not going to be usable for home building. And I asked the representative, are people going to be compensated if they lose a lot? And he couldn't answer that. And I know we have in here that whereas North Carolina law provides a system for determining fair and just compensation due to all affected property owners, that to me was a really weak statement, and I think needs to be a lot stronger about how the property owners would be affected by loss of use if you can't plant your tobacco that year, if you lose a lot or a building site on your land. From my understanding, it's not clear that people will definitely be compensated for those things. And I don't know how you compensate somebody if you take away their ability to have the grandchildren grow up next door. Because, or you have to move. You either have to leave your house and go live somewhere else where you can try to find another lot to do the same thing, or you have to live without that dream. Kelly Bollinger, I think, is not here tonight. I think Daniel is. She sent us an email saying that she had to go to meet the teacher night or something. She said something that really struck me. That she said, you know, I pay my taxes. I do what's right. I obey the law. I work. I don't ask for anything from anybody. I've earned everything. Daniel and I, we've earned everything that we have. And she just wants to be left alone when she turns onto her driveway. She wants to be able to enjoy her property and the things that she has worked for with her family without having to worry that somebody in an office in another state is looking at her land on a satellite picture thinking, well, we can use this and we can use that. And it doesn't belong to them. The Bollingers have a field that was open until not very long ago. They planted it with timber at their own expense, and it has seedlings on it. And the pipeline company wants to uproot those seedlings and put the pipeline through that space because they thought it was an open field because it looked like it on the satellite. It's not an open field for the Bollingers, even if there's nothing planted on it. In their mind, it had the seedlings on it, and now it does. It's not an issue of being compensated for an easement or for the seedlings or for his time in putting them in there, if they would even be compensated for that. It's an invasion. It feels invasive. Eminent domain is called the takings clause for a reason, because something of value is being taken from you. How do you compensate for 100-year-old hardwoods and a person's right to have a forest where they want on their own property? So public policy is about balancing the costs and the benefits, and these landowners clearly bear all the costs and they get virtually none of the benefit, and what benefit they do get is real tangential. But then you come back around to it. We all drove on public roads to get here tonight. Somebody somewhere gave up their land for a road so that people can get around. Mm-hmm. The 119 bypass is being constructed in Mebane right now, and that's being built because other people lost their homes, had them taken away from them. And we all have electricity at home. We use it to cook and wash our clothes, and the ability to have electricity in our homes is based in part on other people having power lines that go over their land, and Duke Energy has shareholders too. And easements are part of how those public services are made available. So my concerns have to do with adequate compensation for these landowners, for the safety environmental record of this particular company, and for the water quality of the Hall River and the Jordan Lake. And I really feel like we lack the staff and the expertise to fully evaluate those competing claims. It's a very complex thing that based on, say, a half hour, 45 minutes from two sides to come to a conclusion about that, I find to be very frustrating. At the end of the day, we don't have any real authority over the ultimate decision about where the pipeline's going to be built, where it's going to go. And the more I listen and the more I think, the more I doubt our ability as a unit of local government to come to a reasonable conclusion about the merits of the pipeline. So I guess that's like a three-page way of saying, I don't know.
I think you're accurate because they've changed the route 5 times since we heard about it. And after the soil survey is done, they may change it again. So at this point, it's very difficult.
So I'd respond by just saying, if there was a really demonstrated need for this eminent domain, and it wasn't driven by the investment of shareholders or owners of this company and the parent companies, then maybe I would agree with you. But I haven't heard that. And there's so much at risk, and we can lose so much that we'll never get back, and the landowners will be able to lose. I mean, I can really be very comfortable with supporting a resolution to not have this, just on those grounds alone. And you know, I'm fine if we want to put something in there that we can change our minds if something transpires that would convince us otherwise. But if we don't, and if the people who are opposed to this aren't successful in stopping it, I mean, it's going to come, and it'll be forever.
Well, the old phrase, beyond a shadow of a doubt, should exist here, just like it does in the courtroom, and it doesn't exist here. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Well, you say that there's no demonstrated need, but you go back to what Mr. Albright put into his draft, and the state of North Carolina, through the North Carolina Utilities Commission, has said that there's a need for additional interstate natural gas pipelines.
As well as the regulation, there's a report that I've attached to your packet from Energy, Water, and Justice Resources, Clean Water for North Carolina, and they make the same, they draw the same conclusion, that Transco is the only pipeline, and then they make the statement that if the pipeline project is expanded, it could potentially make fracking in North Carolina less economically viable because you'll have a high source of natural gas from elsewhere. That's a, was a bizarre conclusion that I found in that. But this is a group that talked about the future growth and need for natural gas. It's very complex.
So is there any consideration in that report on the renewables?
They were talking.
And is there any kind of political associated with that, with the Regulatory Commission?
No, they. This is a group that put a report together.
And how long ago was that?
2014. They were focused mostly on Duke Power's Atlantic Coast pipeline. But they did talk about Transco, and there was only one pipeline that went one direction.
So that's a report from back on another pipeline. Yeah, is that what you're saying?
It concludes that with natural gas generation of electricity, there's going to need be greater needs since and the population's expanding.
Didn't we contact Duke Energy this past week, see where they stood on this?
We did. They said they're not going to take a position one way or another because they're building a competitive line called the Atlantic Coast Pipeline.
Okay.
I think that's why they're not going to comment.
So then this one, maybe, why would they need this one then?
They're going to put 5 new generation plants in the eastern part of North Carolina is what they're saying.
It looks like they're pushing solar. I've seen something just
they are. Duke's got
that.
Solar energy as fast as they can get it put up. Mm-hmm. They're trying to put it up.
And that's good. And I'll tell you, 4 years makes a big difference because my solar panels are 4 years, and I sort of wish I would have waited because the technology is a lot better now.
Well, we talk about alternative sources. Everybody fills their tank up, puts corn alcohol in their tank, ethanol. And you can't grow enough corn. If everybody planted corn across every square foot of the United States, you couldn't supply our alcohol needs to run automobiles. It's just not there. And what's the negative effect of that? The price of corn went up, and cattle that eat corn, price of beef went up. So it's a seamless web. It's a very complex issue, and I'm not an expert in any of this. I'm just trying to come up with a resolution that'll make the five of you happy.
I think I'm with Bob and Bill on that, and I think Tim's saying the same thing, that this is eminent domain without justification.
Well, an eminent domain law.
And we need to
law,
state that somehow in our resolution to just put some
I can flesh that out,
teeth
what,
in it.
What the eminent domain statutes give the person that's property is being taken.
Because what Amy said about power lines and roads, everybody drove here tonight, I think, didn't you?
Right.
On the road. Everybody's got power when you get home at your house, or if you don't, you'd be one of many few our county that doesn't.
Everybody that heats with gas, like I do, with propane gas as a second backup, it's delivered in a truck.
Yeah.
And it's more expensive than natural gas. So it'd be great to have a natural gas line in my neighborhood.
Yeah,
but it's just not
that. This won't guarantee it to anybody.
No.
I don't see where we have anything to lose by making a resolution that we're being asked to make by our constituents. There could be a lot to gain from just from environmental concerns and disruption of people's lives.
Well, they've already had the problem of going through the Jefferson Forest, is what you're talking about here. Same issue when they start tearing up to put that line in. That's why they're being shut down. Mm-hmm.
Well, they had torrential downpours, and
erosion
control washed away. And the federal judge said, your erosion control plan wasn't designed to handle a torrential downpour. Go back and redesign it.
We had a torrential downpour last week.
We had one last night.
Oh,
yeah.
I think we need to table it to our next meeting
and let me put
a draft together.
I've taken your notes.
I've
taken notes on everything you've said.
If that can be done in a timely way where we can respond before it gets on the agenda.
I will work on it this week and get it to you.
All right.
Can we have somebody from county staff attend that meeting Thursday night?
Sure.
Why not?
I'm sorry, I looked at the wrong person. They tell me that's the night. The night you need to ask the questions, get the answers, demand the answers. And no offense, but I got to say this. To tell me that report came out pre-Atlantic versus post-Atlantic, to me there's a great big difference.
Yeah.
Is it what now?
A big difference?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, Duke and Piedmont and two other companies are doing that Atlantic. Three counties to the east of
it's,
us.
It's,
like,
It's an enormous line.
Huh?
It's an enormous line. It's a $5 billion project.
And it's hard for me to believe that if you add through power and Piedmont natural gas, I heat with Piedmont, my electricity, if it's still on when I go home, it's Duke power.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's hard for me to believe that Duke power and Piedmont natural gas are saying we can't take care of the state of North Carolina anymore. I don't believe that. Not for a moment. And again, for that consultant, whoever, to give it pre-Atlantic, that makes sense. But to say that he would have said that after that pipeline, I think those are, 42-inch?
Yeah, they're huge.
They're huge, yeah. And I just have to believe that there's going to be spent off for the rest of the state, not just for the power plants. That's just my personal opinion.
If that does happen, then it'll travel about 150 miles to Alamance County in a pipeline.
So whatever. But I'd like to see us have somebody at that meeting Thursday night. I have to work and I can't be there. Mm-hmm. So and get and take notes and ask questions possibly. You know, if you don't get
if they let us, could we not film it?
I don't know. It's possible.
It might be more like people individually talking to individual people, that it's not a presentation but more of a people.
It's really for the landowners, according to this, to open up to the public to make statements about the project, in addition to not only environmental but cultural resources, and to minimize the overall effect of the project on their land. That's what they claim they want to hear about. So
it's one-on-one, so you're
that's exactly right. That's what the paper states.
Okay, good to know.
Private conversation.
So and Mr. Bird and Mr. Haygood and I cannot be there because we're going to Hickory for the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Conference. So y'all will not see us there, but that is not an indication that we're not interested.
All right.
So is that it for the resolution discussion?
Get back to us.
All right.
I will.
Next on our agenda is the library has a request for bids for the mobile library vehicle. Wait, is that on there? No, that's from my draft. Sorry.
Revised franchise agreement.
The franchise agreement from Mr. Hill. I'm sorry, Mr. Hager.
That's all right.
Take your heart and stop. Your heart is dying.
Can we take?
Let's have a recess, okay? Let's take a 5 minutes recess.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. You got something about the franchise agreement for us, please.
Good evening, Commissioners. A couple of months ago, I came to you guys and asked you to give us a six-month extension so we could try to digest a lot of changes in the recycle market, some changes imposed by House Bill 56, but primarily to buy some time for us to rewrite the franchise agreement for fairness to three major elements. One, the residents, make sure we're putting things in place. That's good for them, for county government, make sure that we can manage this, and also to the vendors, who I think sometimes are carrying the brunt of all the changes that are occurring in the recycle market. In good faith, both of the vendors that we now utilize are here tonight, Norma Yanez from Waste Industries and Tony Krasinko from Republic Services. So if anybody's got any questions outside of what I present, they're both here, more than willing to answer any questions you have about what's going on in this whole international situation we have in the recycle market due to China's sword. I'd also like to recognize Emily Ball, who did a lot of legwork on putting this agreement together. We did a lot of consulting with counties around the state to find out what best practice was, what worked for both the citizens, the governments, and the vendors. So this is a result of that. I sent the package to you with a lot of highlights in yellow. Those yellows highlights were there to make it easy to understand the major changes that were incorporated in the new writing. I'd like to go over those now, and at any time, if you have a question or at the end, we can discuss anything that you may have questions about. First of all, the franchise will be exclusive and tie household garbage and recyclables together under one agreement. So in the past, we had three territories, demographics, and each one of those territories had a recycle and a garbage franchise. We're tying those two together. So when they, when the vendor quotes, they will quote a price for recycle and a price for garbage, and they have to give each resident the option of both choices, independent of each other. The franchisee must offer recyclables collection even if a resident does not participate in garbage and the garbage collection option. This is keeping with our ordinances of trying to promote recycling. Number three, uniform size of garbage and recyclable containers are provided for each residential customer, minimal 65 gallon, maximum 96 gallon. This is to take advantage of the automated trucks that you see with extension arms, can pick it up, saves time, therefore keeps the price lower, going away from the smaller recycle bins. Vendors may provide quotations for any designated service area up to and including all three service areas. So a vendor can choose to simply quote on one area, two areas, or all three, which would be a countywide service. We give them that option. With that option means that if vendors do pick and choose between the areas they want to participate in, and those prices are the lower, you could have different areas of the county being charged different rates. Now that's a function of a couple things. Density of population, mileage, all go into the calculation of what it costs to run those routes. Not sure how homeowners will react to that if Joe across the street is being charged something different from Mary across the street, but it is a function of density. Vendor fees are set for the first 2 years of the new five-year contract. No changes. That's to give everybody a chance to get used to the new vendor and the new system. After that two-year service, the vendor may request a price differential that's tied to a consumer price index. Now, there are a myriad, hundreds of consumer price indexes out there. We picked one that's very broad. And there's reasons for that, not trying just to isolate one particular group of people. Vendor may implement a price differential of 10% of any tipping fee increase at the Alamance County landfill without applying to the Board of Commissioners. An example of that would be if we choose to go up a dollar in our tipping fee, they could automatically, with a letter to you, simply stating they're increasing their price up to a dime. I would give you some foreshadowing here. I see no way to continue to operate in the landfill without increasing tipping fees. The cost of our operations continues to go up. Just got a letter today from American Stone going up 1.5%. We use tons of rock. We haven't increased our tipping fees in 15 years. So something's going to have to change. At Brian's request, we're putting a capital plan together for the next 10 or 15 years. There's going to be lots of discussion that we have not had to have in the past. Methane extrusion, site preparation for the next part of the landfill. These are all multi-million dollar projects that are going to be forced on us if we're going to stay in operation. So we're going to have to address tipping fees. All household garbage collected within the county must be delivered to the Alamance County landfill. And again, that's a function of some of the writings in House Bill 56. All recyclables collected within the county must be delivered to a material recovery facility, what we would call a MRF. There are no MRFs in the county, so that's going to have to go to Greensboro, Durham, other areas. Each franchisee must submit an annual list of subscribers for household garbage and recyclables. We want to know who the customers are. Each franchisee must notify customers within 24 hours of any and all delays in service due to extreme weather conditions, equipment failure, or holidays, and provide alternative schedule. Obviously, technology through blasting of text messages and phones allows that to happen now. We've included insurance requirements to include workman's compensation, commercial liability, and commercial automobile liability. Each franchisee must designate a specific contact person located in North Carolina to respond to customer needs or complaints. So a resident makes a telephone call and wants to complain or get information or change service, isn't talking to somebody in St. Louis. Each franchisee must furnish to the county a performance bond in the minimum of $200,000. Upon review and acceptance of the proposed franchise agreement by the board, the agreement will be used to solicit bids from interested waste and recycling vendors. After all bids have been received, staff will return to the Board of Commissioners at a later date with recommended vendor selections. The new franchise agreements with selected vendors will require two readings by the Board of Commissioners. Any questions?
How do we compare in tipping fees to other surrounding landfills?
At Bruce's request, probably about 4 months ago, I spent a lot of time on the database with DEQ looking at that. I think there's 41 public landfills around the state. We also broke it down regional. I took the 15 most neighboring counties and compared. We are below the state average for what I think was $3 to $4 per ton, and we're right in the mix on the regional average. One also has to look at standard deviation, because there's enormous variation. You go to some of the mountain areas, the price may be double what ours is. It may be half what ours is. It's all according to how they're structured, whether they're community-based, whether they're regional-based. So I would tell you we're on the cheap end. I think tipping fees are also going to be a function of where we are in the maturity of our landfill. We're just simply starting to give out a space from the areas that are permitted. We're going to have to go forward with that. It's going to be expensive.
Is this a presentation tonight for information? We don't have a vote tonight.
You don't have to vote tonight. Me bidding it is just a function of when you're comfortable with it.
What's the status of the regional down in Randolph?
Well, going strong. Obviously, I think their number one client was Greensboro. They went out and really bid at an incredibly low price. I think it was $19 a ton.
It was less than 20, yes.
And that was something like a 1 or 2 year agreement. That price would go up a lot. We visited there about a year ago, 6 months to a year ago. Very nice operation, a lot of technology. Has not had an impact on us. One of the things we are concerned about with House Bill 56, it stripped away our ability as a local government to force the municipalities to bring their garbage to us. We never put that in our ordinance, but it was always available to us. Unless Clyde tells me about any changes, I know he was researching this a week or two ago.
They did make some changes to it, but I haven't had a chance to flesh them out. The last week of the session brought a number of changes at the last minute.
So what I'm telling you may be wrong. But we need to make sure that the trash volume continues if we're going to stay competitive. I will tell you there is a demonstrated increase in volumes. We are permitted for 100,000 tons. Under 100,000 tons per year, which equates to about 300 tons a day. On a 5.5 day work schedule, we have days of well over 500,000 pounds coming in. I mean, we're seeing dramatic growth. A lot of that seems to be come from the commercial side. I think Mebane's having a big impact on that. Obviously, we closed our C&D operation, so all of that trash is now going to MSW. Didn't really matter which hole in the ground it went in as far as volume, but it's increasing. Growth is there.
Let me ask you, how, when those trucks come in, are they weighed before they're dumped?
Two things can happen. A lot of the commercial traffic through the municipalities, we do a pre-weight. From time to time, we weigh them empty, so we know what their weight is. So when they come in, we don't have to spend the time to actually weigh them again. We know that on our computer system, and then we just weigh how much they are, and we net it out and charge them. For those times when you have a new vehicle, a new vendor, or you're just doing an audit, you have to weigh them coming in and going out. But most of your commercial traffic does have a pre-weight already in it.
I met a guy from Orange County. I think he manages the landfill, solid waste.
Mr. Johnson?
Maybe. And he was asking, wouldn't we want to allow him to use our landfill, he'd make it financially worth our while.
Well, we talked about this about 6 months ago. I brought it to your attention.
Excited,
Yeah. It's all a function of dollars and how much volume of space you have. As of now, we do everything under the rules of maximizing the life of the landfill and doing so at the cheapest price available.
Great.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Now let's talk about the sale of the Woody Drive property.
Okay.
At the last meeting, I told the board about the offer from the Burtons. They're here tonight. And I provided you with two resolutions. After our meeting, I received a phone call where their offer changed a little bit. He wants to buy the 5.7-acre billboard parcel as well as the other parcel, 6.31 acres, which brings the total to 6.88 acres. And he's willing to make that offer tonight. And if the board accepts his offer, then under 168-269, what we would do, we would advertise that. The ad would go in the paper on Thursday, would run for 10 days, and we would open up any competitive bids that we receive on Tuesday morning at 8:30. And then at 9 o'clock, I'd march in here and tell you if we had any competitive bids. And if we do have competitive bids, 10-day period starts over again. We have to advertise again and put it out there again. And then Mr. Burton, if he's outbid, can come in and outbid the outbidder. And all that goes on in an upset bid process till no one else is upset. So anyway, I just love saying that. But the board tonight has a decision to make whether to accept it, whether to reject it. Now, if you accept his offer and we publish the notice, then you still have to confirm him as the high bidder, and at that point you can still reject the offer. But that's what I put before the board tonight.
Okay, we have two things. One of them is, if we're going to decide to sell both partials,
right,
as a group, as one, or not sell.
Or if you just want to sell the 6.31 acre where the building was torn down.
Brian, what do you think about keeping that billboard? We get $10,000 a year, and basically he's going to pay us for 10 years. That's a good return on our money. Mm-hmm. What do you think? You tell me what you think.
So I would suggest to the board that we don't sell the property at all until we finish our facility plan. This is the same line I've taken with the board for the past couple of months. We're working on a facility plan. We believe it'll be finished by the end of this fiscal year. No, excuse me, the end of this calendar year. I would suggest we wait to make any decisions to sell any property or divest ourselves of anything until then, but I understand that this is an attractive offer for you to entertain. So I would ask the board to consider waiting, but again, I know you have a large
got a ready, willing buyer.
Yeah.
So one reason I like the wait, I mean, the value of the property is more, it has to do with what's going to end up, how the property is going to end up being used, and the property that the Burtons already have. I mean, so it's possible, for example, in their favor, we sell them the property, and that enables them to develop the next door property that they already own for, say, industrial use, right, which is then going to generate a tax, increasing our tax base. I mean, I'm interested in increasing our tax base.
Sure.
And having something there that environmentally friendly, that pays good taxes. That's more important what the purchase price is of the property. And they mentioned last time, well, maybe the best use of the property would be if a hotel came. I don't know if that would generate more.
I don't know that anybody would pay any more for the land than what it's appraised, really.
Right, yeah. Right. So, but they're
not going to be in business. No.
But I'm more interested in what the property's going to be used for and how that can help us financially than I am just with my purchase price.
Yeah, I tend to agree with Mr. Bird on that, because I think that being a unit of government, that is different than if we were just a seller. You know, I'm selling my house, whoever buys it, and I move on. I don't really have a big interest in what they do with the property. But since we are a taxing authority, we do have an interest in what whoever buys the property does with it subsequently. We would like to see not only get good value for the lot itself, because it has that value, but also, you know, you mentioned the revenue stream from the billboard. mean, it's a revenue stream to the county from the taxes of whatever happens on it.
It's going to be a revenue to us.
Right.
Well, I'm going to make the motion that we sell it to them, but not the billboard.
So that would be, a motion would be to sell just the 6.31 acres.
And that's for $537,000. Is that offer acceptable to you gentlemen?
More acceptable with the billboard.
What's the?
I mean, the billboard has an easement. We just want to do it where the easement's not involved, because later on, we got to deal with that easement if we buy the property.
Right.
And I we want to keep, we like to keep security in our place. We don't like people coming through our property we really have the whole thing.
How much more money would the billboard?
$100,000.
They've offered $100,000 more for the billboard.
How much land is it?
It's 0.57 acre.
Or just half an acre.
Yes. That is right away through that.
It's got a right away through that billboard.
It's in a gully. And when we file the new plat, we put a deeded 25-foot access right of way to it. So no one could ever stop us from working on it or stop Fairway from changing the sign up.
But at the end of the process, if we got a second on Bill's motion and then approved it, then we're starting a bidding process that at the end of it, if we don't like the result of it, we can still say, no, we're not selling it.
That's correct. The statute says, the last sentence, you may reject at any time any and all offers.
So we're not fully committing to anything if we...
What we're doing is starting a process to advertise for upset bids.
But it would help our company to add that 6 acres. We do have some plans, and that 6 acres will come in effect.
And he's an Alamance County businessman.
Right.
It would help us as a business. I mean, and we've just been there a year, but we're not going nowhere.
So can I ask a question then?
Yeah.
And maybe you can't even answer it, but so what's the taxable value of the property that you own right now with however it's
going? We own now.
$2.5 million.
$2.5 million?
Yeah.
And if,
I presume if we buy it for six, it's going to be six at that part that you're selling now.
Well,
your improvements. Until you do your improvements.
Yeah, that's right.
Right, until we do your improvements, yeah, but right now you're not getting any.
Right.
But I know last time.
Exactly.
You get zero.
The last time you, what I understood you to say was that by having this property.
Step up here so you can have a face-to-face conversation.
And Brian doesn't have to in his head. But so what I understood from your last time you were here was that buying this property would enable your other property to get a tenant or somebody there that could, it would improve the value of the property from like manufacturing or whatever.
If we want to double size our building,
we're
going to
have 30 acres instead of 22.
Yeah.
I mean, so my question boils down to this. How much extra tax value do you think that your existing property would be as a result of buying this other property from us?
$647,000.
Yeah, $647,000.
Sticking to that, right?
I mean, if you were
unless
telling
we had
that,
own, you know,
that you really weren't wanting to develop the building that you already have, and get a tenant in there that was a really, a manufacturing company or some other industry.
That's right.
That would generate a tax base more than the $2 million that's
I'm
worth
sure
now.
I'm sure it will.
Mm-hmm.
And if you
but
were.
There's no way you can quantify that now.
As far as a hotel, if a hotel wants to come, they got other places they can build, and you're still going to get tax on it.
Right.
It's not the only place that a hotel can go there. You know what I'm saying?
That's the only one we own.
It was. You do have one right beside us, though. You know.
Yeah.
But anyway, we would have our business, and I think we're giving a fair offer. We gave the appraisal price, 10-year up front on the lease. We're not making anything for 10 years.
I do kind of value Brian's plan. I don't know what the timing is. What's the timeline for the study?
By the end of the year.
They may have a business
so a
paying
months.
Taxes by then, though.
Yeah.
Well, we've been talking a year and a half.
Yeah,
we've been
talking a year.
Right.
And I ain't nothing against Brian, but Brian's doing
Let me say, the burdens have been very pleasant to deal with. This is nothing to do with any critique of your business or your plans.
No, certainly. And I don't know the whole situation with the county, but I know it's been postponed for a year and a half.
Right.
We gotta wait.
And of course, another 4 or 5 months.
There's a lot of
people you're talking to may not wait 4 or 5. Is that what you're
saying? We've got deals working right now.
So you're in it. You're really actively working on something.
Yeah, we're actively working on something. And it would help us tremendously if we could get the whole package.
Yeah.
And be done with that easement. We don't have to worry about who's coming beside us.
Or putting up with somebody coming across the property.
And certainly we're here to make money. Good night. I mean, that's what we're in business
but
for.
But you're putting it out
and
there.
That's how we pay our taxes, you know. So, I mean.
Well, I'm interested in
so help us out a little bit.
More taxes for our schools.
Yeah, right.
County staff.
Like I say, it'd be 28 acres if we could get the 6, and that's more attractive to bigger industries. I mean, tractor trailers take a lot of space sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
So, anyway. So help us out, and let's vote yes and go home.
Well, we have a motion to sell just the 6.31 acres for $537,000.
That's correct.
But we don't have a second, so.
So you're saying 5 or 6?
I thought we ought to just get rid of the whole blasted thing.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to that.
And billboard in there, and I don't think they're going to put Lashley and Sutton for commissioner on the billboard, so.
Maybe something we can talk about, right?
Oh, yeah, never know.
I'm teasing.
I would make a motion that we sell them both parcels and put it out there for bid and see how it goes.
I'll second.
So we have Mr. Boswell has made a motion to offer the 6.88 acres for $637,000.
So, is that what you're
saying? So I do like the idea of working with an existing business.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And yeah. Mr. Sutton has seconded it. And I'll say that I would go with Mr. Haygood's suggestion and wait until after we've done our analysis of everything. The capital, what do you call it? The capital plan.
Facilities plan.
Facilities plan. I would prefer to wait until we have the facilities plan completed before we.
But in reality, you can't put a county office on 100, you know.
Yeah, we talked about
that's
that.
Too expensive piece of dirt for that.
What are we talking about?
Well, the same attributes that make it attractive to the Burtons are attractive to some functions of county government, particularly emergency services. Its location is key, access to the interstate. I can't tell you that we would need it.
We'll go across the street and see if the school board would get rid of that down there.
Yeah,
no, I don't think that property, for the best use of that property, would be for county purposes.
No, it's, I mean, I'm not in
I doubt very much that the facilities.
Well, there's a motion, and I call for the question.
I agree. We have a motion and a second to sell the entire 6.88 acres for $637,000. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. So that motion carries.
Four to one.
Thank you.
I will prepare the notice, and I will look for a 5% check from this gentleman tomorrow.
All right. You got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you all very much.
Okay. Mr. Haygood, do you have a report tonight?
Update the board on the Guilford County line. The state of North Carolina will be sending a letter to property owners here after the 1st of September to let them know that that process has been completed. And then Alamance County, we will be sending a letter to all Alamance County residents along the Guilford County line with more details about what this means for them when it comes to appraisals and those kind of things. We're also going to do a letter and set up a website for property owners to be able to go to and see the same information about how appraisals will work, and also touching on the fact that we will have school children that will need to fill out some forms with county government. We'll be coordinating with the school system about making sure that they're able to stay in the school system where they currently are. Bruce and Marlena and Clyde have been working very hard on this process, and it's a good thing to be able to report that it's and Jeremy, absolutely, yes. It's nice to be able to report that it's finalized, and we're now working through the details of letting the property owners know what that means to them. So, If you have any questions, we can try to answer them, but I just want to make sure you knew, because you may get calls from folks when they start getting those letters from the state, as well as from us. And that's all that I have.
Great, thank you. Do we have any commissioner comments?
No, ma'am.
I have one little thing. I'm a member of the VFW Post 10607 Auxiliary, and the VFW Post is having a exhibit called The Eyes of Freedom that is going to be coming on Wednesday afternoon, October 3rd. It's a traveling memorial for veterans. It's
You say 3rd, October 3rd?
Yes.
What time?
It doesn't say what time they're going to get there. It was the motorcycle escort. Here, this is the car.
Yeah, give us
I have
a
that
car.
To pass out.
Otherwise, we'll forget it. Time to go.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So this is a nationally traveling military tribute recognizing Marines from Lima 325 and those who fought and died. The memorial includes 23 life-size portraits of the men killed in Iraq after being deployed in 2005, along with each soldier's combat boots and a candle to memorialize each man's fighting spirit. And it's going to be on display from Thursday through Saturday, October 4th through 6th, and then on Sunday, October 7th and 10th. The VFW would really like for everybody to know about it and to find the time to come out.
And this is going to be in the mall?
Yes.
Is that worse?
It's going to be in the mall. So that is all that I had to say about that. Anybody else? Okay. With nothing further before the board will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.